I got a great wife and kids. And I think if I didn't join the martial arts, I probably wouldn't have had all that. I would have been in a much different situation.
Hello, everyone. It's episode 84 of Whistlekick Martial Arts Radio, the only place to hear the best stories from the best martial artists, like today's guest, Master Chris LaCava. My name's Jeremy Lesniak, and I founded Whistlekick, but I'm also your host here for Martial Arts Radio. I'm proud to say that Whistlekick makes the world's best sparring gear, as well as really great apparel and accessories, all for practitioners and fans of traditional martial arts. Thank you to the returning listeners, and hello and welcome to those of you listening for the first time. If you're not familiar with our products, you should take a look at what we make. Our sparring gear is the heart of what we do. Boots, gloves, shin guards, and helmets that are not only more comfortable, they're designed better and routinely last 2 years with heavy use. You can check out our testimonials, videos, or place an order at our website, whistlekick.com. If you want to see the show notes, those are on another website, whistlekickmartialartsradio.com. While you're over there, sign up for the newsletter. We offer special content to subscribers, and it's the only place to find out about upcoming guests for the show. We only email a few times a month, we never sell your information, and sometimes we even mail at a discount. Today's episode is with Master Chris LaCava, another of the wonderful martial artists I first met in 2015 at the Super Summer Seminars event. We didn't get a lot of time together that weekend, but I saw him again in January at the Hall of Honors Mega Weekend in New Jersey. After getting another chance to train with him, I knew it was time to get him on the show. And here we are. Master LaCava, welcome to Whistlekick Martial Arts Radio.
Thanks for having me.
Hey, thanks for being here. This is going to be a lot of fun for listeners out there. We've had a little bit more of a pre-show than I'm used to. You know, sometimes guests come on and we just start chatting and forget that we're actually here to have an episode and not just shoot the breeze. So I've got a feeling this is going to be a really fun episode. So thanks for your time.
Cross your fingers. It's going to be great. For the best, brother.
Hey, I'm going to cross one hand and then I got the pen poised in the other for, which are all the things that we've got to edit out that are awful and terrible.
Oh, don't worry. We'll take care of it in post.
Without a doubt. So, listeners might be picking up on the fact that I know you a little bit. We've got not a ton, but yeah. You know, I've spent a little bit of time with you training. Yeah. So why don't you tell everybody how you got started in the martial arts?
Oof. I got started in the martial arts. I'm like a cliche. I was the little weak kid with glasses that got beat up by the bullies. And you know, henceforth, I guess, when I was younger, I had anger management issues. And, you know, I grew up watching Kung Fu Theater on Saturday mornings, watching like Shaw Brothers movies, you know, like Master Killer, all those great movies. Invincible Shaolin, you got Five Deadly Venoms, you know, all those things. And I was just like, oh my God, that's awesome. And so, you know, I eventually said to my parents, I was like, I want to do martial arts. I want to do kung fu. I want to do karate. And my mother was like, oh, hell no. We are not giving you a license to kill. You can't even keep it in control. We're not giving you that ability. And it wasn't until a friend of the family who was a Don rank in Kung Sudo, he said, you know what? It's probably just what he needs. And that was the beginning of me getting into martial arts.
So tell us a little bit more. So this person encouraged you from Tang Sudo. Is that what you started with?
He didn't really encourage me. I was already fired up, ready to go.
Encouraged the family.
He actually talked to my mother and my father about, you know, the benefits of martial arts and how, you know, it can instill discipline and self-control and all these kinds of great things. And they were like, you know what? All right, let's try it. We can always yank them, you know, get them out of it if necessary. But it was actually a huge benefit for me. You know, it helped me calm down. It helped me give me a better outlook on life and how to deal with things. You know, we talk about conflict resolution, the physical, but it also gave me a lot with the mental, you know, how to look at things and put things in perspective. And, you know, it's all about the filter. You know, how am I actually viewing this? And it was a great thing for me, especially younger. It's probably the reason why I'm not in jail.
Really? Do you say that seriously?
Well, I was pretty angry. Okay.
All right.
And I think, you know, I think I could have made very poor choices back then, and this gave me the ability to make better choices. And I'm really happy with the way things have turned out. You know, I've got great friends. I've got a great family. I got a great wife and kids. And I think if I didn't join the martial arts, I probably wouldn't have had all that. I would have been in a much different situation. You know, I joke saying, oh, I'd be in jail. But I don't know, to be honest. I couldn't say whether or not. I just know that I wasn't a great kid. You know, I wasn't ridiculously terrible, but, you know, I just wasn't a great behavior. You know, I didn't have a great behavior or whatever, you know. So this definitely, martial arts was definitely something that I can appreciate and look back on and saying, yep, that definitely helped.
Well, it's great that you found it.
Oh,
then,
no doubt.
Because who knows where you could have slid, for
yeah,
sure.
Yeah.
So, of course, here on Martial Arts Radio, it's all about stories. You know, we talked about that earlier before we started the episode. Stories are kind of what make everything tick, you know?
Right.
Before there was the written word, there was stories. And I'm sure you've got a bunch. So why don't you think for a second? Tell us your best one.
Oh, like we were mentioning before, because they're my stories, they're just my stories. They don't seem like anything special, you know, until one comes out and somebody goes, oh yeah, I dig that. Or, oh no, I really connect with that. Up to that point, it's like, it's just my story. It's just where I've been and just what I've done. You know, they just don't have that spark that other people's stories have. Like, I could listen to somebody else talk for hours. Trust me. That's why I'm with my wife. She doesn't stop talking. No, no, I love you, honey. I'm just playing. But, yeah, a good story. Give me a topic and maybe I can come up with one.
Well, I know you teach seminars.
Yeah.
Anything crazy ever happened there? I know when I saw you in January, when I was in on one of your sessions there, I was working with the first martial artist I'd ever worked with a serious mullet, a Korean with a mullet. I mean, not that that's a long story, but that happened under your watch.
Okay.
So there's got to be more.
Oh, God. A seminar related story. Not a great story, but I remember being down in Mississippi, and I was down at one of Grandmaster J.R. West's Hapkido International conferences, and had a great time training. I met Jeff Booth and Rudy Timmerman, and you know, I was a little fanboyish. You know, I was like, and they invited me to dinner afterwards. Well, I had a great time at dinner, and when people get to know me, they know I like to eat. And so good conversation, good food. We're getting close to finishing. And I look down at my watch and I'm like, oh crap. I was like, I just missed my plane. We all laughed. And my wife was like, figures you would, because you were eating, you missed your damn plane, you know? But like I said, not a great story, but it was one that made me go, yep. Chris LaCava, what do you think so far?
May not be a long story, but that's a pretty great story.
Oh man, when I was really honored that they asked me to go out for dinner with them. You know, all these bigwigs, and here I am. I'm like, yeah, I'd love to go. So, any good stories? Good stories.
I've got a feeling we'll end up with more.
Yeah.
So let's just keep rolling. Right. I mean, that's a great way to punctuate that question. I don't think there's anything wrong with it. So let's take a step out. Let's, you know, we talked a little bit in the first question about what your life could have been like mm-hmm. without the martial arts. So I want to take you back there, and let's pretend that Tangsido friend didn't encourage your parents, and your parents never relented, and you didn't get to do the martial arts.
Yep.
Where do you think your life would be now?
I think I wouldn't have the determination I do now. I don't think I would have had the work ethic that I do now. I'm a classic ADD child. I have the attention span of a gnat. When my wife and I watched the movie Up, that Pixar movie or one of those kind of cartoon movies, the dog would be like, doo, 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 and then he goes, squirrel. And then we just look off, and that's me. So I think the martial arts definitely helped me there. And my backstory, a little bit of my backstory is I was a professional musician. I used to play in bands, and I, recorded CDs and been on TV and the radio, and I went on tour in Europe and blah blah blah. And I think back is like, if I wasn't in the martial arts, I wouldn't have put up with all the stuff that I needed to put up with and all the work I needed to do to accomplish those things. So where would I be without my martial arts? I would be one unhappy person. Would I be in jail? I don't know. I just know my life wouldn't be as fulfilled and as happy as it is now. It's probably a place that I wouldn't want to be. Yeah, I couldn't really tell you a specific, but it's probably some place I'd rather not be. And I'm very fortunate to be where I am now.
Fair enough, and lines up pretty well with what most of the guests we've had on the show have said.
Oh, cool. I'm not alone.
You're definitely not alone. Absolutely not. So I'd like you to think back.
You're trying to get me
We've
to
all
talk
got
about jail, aren't you? I keep see hearing this
I
recurring theme.
you brought it up. You're the one that put it on the table. Sounds like great fodder for a podcast. Why
You
not,
just keep reserving
pick
those
at that
leftovers,
thread? Hey, sometimes you throw ketchup on it and it's like a whole new
There you
meal.
go. No, go ahead. I'm sorry.
It's quite all right. So we all have highs and lows in life, and I'd like you to think back to one of your lows and how your martial arts training or just time helped you move past it.
I remember one of my lows had to deal with martial arts. I was teaching at my own place in Westport, Connecticut, and things were going really well. I had a lot of students, we were having good times, we were training hard, everything was great. But then, life kind of gets in the way for people and people kind of fall off track and everything. And the numbers started going down, and I had a hard time paying the bills, both for the school and for my house, or for my home, excuse me. And it was looking kind of bleak. And I'm like, what am I going to do? I mean, do I need to quit this and not do martial arts anymore? Because to be honest, I couldn't afford classes. If I stopped doing this, I couldn't afford classes. So it was like, it would be like I'm giving up on martial arts altogether. And that kind of really hurt inside. And so one day I end up going to the school. And I can't remember the name of the tropical storm, but it came through Connecticut and ripped everything up, in all the surrounding areas. And it was really bad. So I ended up going to the school and I had this sign. It was like my logo, LaCava's Martial Arts, and it was hanging up on the building. And when I got there, I saw it like it was like all the way across the parking lot, leaned up against a tree, all bashed up and damaged. And I was like, oh my God, is this a sign? It's like, is it time to pack up? But, because of my support system, my family, my friends, and when I say my friends, I mean, my people in the martial arts as well. It's not just, outside martial arts. A lot of people think that, oh, you have martial arts and you have, your real life. My martial arts is my real life, So with the support of all my friends, my family, and my previous training in martial arts, it's like, you know what? Suck it up. Move on. You gotta adapt and overcome, So that was probably a really low point for me. And it was the martial arts and my other support mechanism that really got me through it. And now now I'm traveling around the world and, you know, teaching seminars and whatnot. I'm loving life. But if I had just packed up and let it go at that moment, none of this would have happened. So that was a low part. And thank God for martial arts, got me through it.
Yeah, I think, you know, there's a little bit of a literary device there, for lack of better terminology, that, you know, was your sign being ripped off your building a sign?
Yeah. So,
you know, pretty poignant. And, you know, I think a lot of people would have taken that as a sign to, okay, I'm done, I'm going to fold. And clearly you didn't do that. And so what do things look like today for you? I'm assuming they're better.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I do a lot of seminars. Like I said, I travel around and I really dig it. I love doing seminars. I like sharing what I've learned. You know, it's like giving back. But all the people I get to meet along the way, you know, people that become my family, it's really awesome. It's really made my life much richer. It's made me be able to go places physically and emotionally and spiritually that, you know, I wouldn't have been able to get to if I wasn't, you know. It's made my life very rich because of that. So seminars is where I'm really doing the most work and really enjoying it.
Cool. So I know you've had the chance to train under some pretty great people and certainly train with some people at seminars. Mm. And if we add in all the seminars that you're doing, I mean, you've trained with tons and tons of people. But other than your immediate instructors, mm-hmm. If I said, you know, if I asked you, who was the most influential person on your martial arts career, who would that be?
Keith St. Amand. He is absolutely the most influential, because if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't be in martial arts. He is the one that talked to my family about getting me into it. And that, him going out of his way to talk to my family to help me out, was really something that was poignant for me. That is like, he didn't have to do that. He was getting nothing out of it. He was just doing that to make another person happy, to benefit someone else, to make their life richer, you know? And that always stuck with me. And I think that's one of the things I try to do every day, you know, whether that's, you know, at a seminar, whether that's at the supermarket, whether that's at the bank, or whether that's, well, I'm walking down the street, it doesn't matter. I really like being able to affect someone's life in a positive way. I forgot who the quote was by, but they said something to the effect of, you know what, hold on one sec, let me try to find that quote. If we're going to actually.
Yeah, that's fine.
Let me see here. It was by Ralph Waldo Emerson. He had said, to laugh often and much, to win the respect of intelligent people and the affection of children, to leave the world a better place, to know even one life has breathed easier because you have lived, this is to have succeeded. That hits me hard. And that really strikes me, you know. And that's kind of my motto, or the way I try to live my life.
Yeah. Now, have you found that inspirational in your path as a teacher?
As far as on the receiving end, or what?
Yeah. Well, I mean, obviously this is, you know, that quote kind of punctuates the beginning of your martial arts career. You know, I mean, whether or not this gentleman knew of that quote when he spoke to your parents, we don't know, but I mean, the sentiment was there.
Right. Oh no, absolutely. What he did makes that, you know, perfectly. But even though it might mark my beginning, it marks my middle, and hopefully it marks my end as well. That's just something that I will take with me for my entire life.
Right on. And I think a lot of people that teach, whether it's martial arts or something different, feel similarly. I know that for me, not that I have my own school anymore, but when I am instructing, being at a seminar or at the school I train at, that when I get that one interaction, you know, which doesn't happen very often, but when I know I've made an impact, whether or not it's on someone's martial arts or, you know, a parent or even an adult comes up to me and says, you know, that thing you said really stuck with me and made a difference, and here's how I applied it to my life. I mean, there's nothing better for me.
That's heavy, man.
Than that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
No, amen, brother. Preach on, brother. You know what I'm talking about. Can I get an amen from my brother in the front row? That would be you.
Oh, amen. Amen. Well, you know, I'm not sitting in a pew. In fact, I'm standing up. So.
Oh, now you're standing up.
I got to stand up with this microphone.
Oh, gotcha.
No chairs. I'm fully engaged. My hamstrings are engaged in order to talk to you even. So,
is your core fully engaged?
It's not. Oh, dude, it's not.
Let's get on that, all right?
I'll work on it.
All right, next question.
So let's talk about competition. Has that ever been something that's come across your plate?
When I was younger, yeah. I used to be in a lot of tournaments, but as I got older, I didn't really do as much. But when I did do tournaments, it was all about, you know, that classic, either I win or I learn. And that's the way I've always gone through tournaments. You know, it's all right. Yeah, I may not have won, but I still got something out of it. I still learned, what am I weak at? What do I need to work on? You know, that's just something I got from my parents. It's not somebody else's fault. It's your fault. It's not that it's your fault. It's what can you do to make it better? So, you know, with losing at tournaments, it's like, all right, I didn't win, but what can I do to win next time? And that definitely helped drive me on as far as tournaments are concerned. I used to do well in tournaments, you know, but occasionally you get those tournaments where there's just some serious, serious hardcore competition. You don't always make it out on top, and that's okay. So at least, you know, you get to test your mettle, you know?
Yeah, you don't get better being the best in the room.
That's right. Yeah.
Right on. Now, if you could train with someone that you haven't, and we'll even open up to the dead people.
Okay.
If you could train with anybody that's ever lived,
who
would that be and why?
Who would I train with, living or dead, that I haven't currently trained with? Okay.
Yes.
Because I'm a Hapkido guy, I think I would want to train with Chaeyoung-sul. My teacher was one of the longest running students to train with Chaeyoung-sul, and Chaeyoung-sul was the founder of Hapkido. And when Dojinim Che closed his school in 1976, he taught out of my teacher's school until his death in 86. My teacher spent a lot of time with him, and he would talk about him and whatnot. And you hear all these different stories. You know, I hear a lot of the stories you hear outside is like, oh, he was a mean, angry person. And some people will say that. Other people say he's warm-hearted and blah, blah, blah. I think it really depends on who you are is how he treated you. But, you know, because I also like digging into history and stuff like that, I would like to train with him not only for technique, but just to pick his brain and just find out a lot of the stuff that's going on. Because in martial arts, you know, as the history grows longer, it gets muddier and muddier, and people don't know what's true, what's not. And I think that, for me, I think Chaeyoung-sul would be the guy I would want to, the person I would want to train with.
Yeah, I think one of the things that's interesting about looking back over some of these arts and comparing them to newer arts is intention.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we might have the forms, we might have the movements from styles that are, you know, 75 to 100 years old, but we don't really have the intention. What was the purpose? Why was this done this way? Whereas, you know, the other instructors of that time were teaching it a different way.
Absolutely. That's so interesting to me. You know, knowing the whys, not just the hows, but the whys, that's makes it so much more solid, you know? And of course, being a teacher, you'd like to share that with other people as well. So yeah, no, I'm with you.
Because movements can change, especially if you understand the why.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when if our path is to do a punch in this particular way, well, that path never changes.
Right.
But if the path is to throw the strongest punch or the fastest punch or a punch as a counter to this movement,
that could be modified.
That may change. Yeah. As we understand the body better, as new techniques develop, as people grow. Mm-hmm. I mean, as humanity, we're getting taller. I didn't get any of that, but other people have.
You're perfect, brother. Don't you sweat it.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. All 5.5 feet of me. So just to pick at that a little bit more. So do you think that because you've spent so much time training with a man who had trained with the founder of Hapkido, you have a better understanding of those whys? Is that something that you talk to him about?
Yeah. I mean, I would like to say I have a better understanding, but you know, the more I know, the more I realize I don't know. So, I want to know some of the whys. I want to know because, all right. So to preface that, if I trained with him, we'd also be able to speak the same language. Because right now my teacher speaks very good English, but sometimes my Korean is not as good as his English. And sometimes things may get a little, you know, messed up. So I don't get the full understanding of it at times. But I think I would love to be able to one, speak Korean better, but, you know, I would like to talk with Jae-Yong-Soo and really, you know, pick his brain about that, the whys, because to me, it would make it so much more solid, so much more fulfilled, you know, because I'm not just a technician. I'm not just a technician. You know, I want to know more about it.
Yeah. You ever thought about writing a book? That seems like something would be up your alley.
No, I don't write.
No? You don't write?
I don't write at all. I'm a terrible writer. I would be one of those guys that had to hire somebody to do it. You know anybody?
Not that's available. I'm sure maybe there's somebody listening that wants to help you write a book on Hapkido.
That would be awesome. Hopefully it would be interesting enough that people would want to buy it.
People seem to buy a lot of books that shouldn't be read. And I would imagine if you wrote a book, it should be.
All right. So there's hope, what you're saying.
There's definitely hope. At least there's intent.
Cool.
Let's talk about movies.
Oh, yeah.
So movies kind of launched your desire.
Oh, hell yeah.
To participate in the martial arts.
Absolutely.
Now, how about other movies? Do you have a favorite? Let's start there.
Outside of the martial arts genre?
No, inside the martial arts genre.
Martial arts movie, Five Deadly Venoms.
Okay, why?
I thought it was so cool. You had these five guys that were in this group, and they were all such badasses. And they all had their specific styles, and each had these individual things that made them special. And I just thought that was so cool. And of course, you had the mask and the mystery of it. Oh my God, who's the toad? Who's the lizard? You know, and that was just a very cool movie for me as far as martial arts and just movies in general. So definitely Five Deadly Venoms, favorite movie, favorite kung fu movie.
You know, there's this interesting pattern that for a lot of us that those early movies that kind of pushed us in the martial arts, or at least were there when we started, have stayed as our favorites. Mm-hmm. Throughout, we've had plenty of people on the show who started the martial arts because of one of Bruce Lee's movies. Mm-hmm. And that movie has stayed one of their favorites, if not their favorite
right.
film. Over those years, and you mentioned Five Deadly Venoms in the beginning.
I did.
As one of those movies, so just kind of keeping that going. If I forced you to pick a couple more?
As far as kung fu movies or martial art movies? Okay,
yeah.
All right. So I'm going to pick one more back in the day, Master Killer. Master Killer. That was a great movie. I used to love that, how you go to the Shaolin Temple and train and all the movies that had the different training apparatus and all the different things you had to do in training, to me, that just like made it so much cooler. It's like, oh my gosh. you know, you got Jackie Chan movies where they would do that. What was that? Drunken Master, I think it was, where,
think
you
so.
know, that was so cool. Another movie that I really liked, Fist of Legend with Jet Li.
Yeah.
I really liked that movie. You know, you got the history of the Chinese versus the Japanese and all that. Yeah. But the movie in general as a whole was just so well put together. The choreography, the storyline, the character development, all that stuff was just so cool. And that's another, you know, martial arts movie that I really appreciate. Iron Monkey. I liked Iron Monkey. Yeah. And right there with Iron Monkey, you have, you know, the martial and the medical together in one movie, which is very cool. Yeah, because I'm a licensed acupuncturist, I get off on that kind of stuff, you know.
Yeah,
you know, so anytime I see, you know, Eastern medicine and martial arts put together in a movie, you know, it's like, oh yeah, you know. So I dig that. And those are my top four. Most of the Shaw Brothers movies I just really dug, you know. As far as if I had to pick one more, what would I pick? Oh no, that was five, wasn't it? I think they picked five. Five Deadly Venoms.
Yeah, no, I
Master
think
Killer.
I think that's pretty good.
Yeah. Fist of Legend. What was that? Yeah, that's enough. Plenty of good movies to check out, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, there's this. So one of the things that happens as part of our marketing strategy here at Whistlekick is we spend a lot of time on social media. There's a lot of stuff that gets pushed out. And I don't know why, but I feel like I need to ask you if you've at least heard of this movie that's just popped back up called Miami Connection.
Miami Connection. No.
So this was this like really terrible self-financed Taekwondo movie done out of Miami in like 87. Uh-huh. This Taekwondo grandmaster and he like went broke in like the first 3 days doing it. So it's all of his students and it's just kind of popped back up. And it's this, everyone that's seen it has said, this movie is far better than it deserves to be. So, I'll try and throw a link out there. I haven't,
I check it out.
It keeps ending up in a tab in my computer to watch it. And I keep running out of time.
I definitely
but
check
it's
that
just,
out.
Check it out, listeners, if you can find it online. It seems like it's going through these rights issues. People put it up and then it gets taken down. So try and find it. And
what was the name of it again?
Miami Connection.
Miami Connection. Do you know who the practitioner was that the star of it?
YK Kim.
YK Kim. Okay.
Just this little Korean guy with a whole bunch of stripes on his belt. And runs this huge school down in Miami now, and he's had all this press for this re-release. I mean, just crazy stuff. I mean, this is, in watching the bits that I have, it reminds me of Scarface.
Okay.
Not at all in plot, but in terms of style and terrible music and,
okay.
and hair and all of these things. So if anybody's out there a fan of 80s movies and wants to check out a possibly terrible, possibly not terrible 80s movie, we'll link all that. For anybody that's new to the show, whistlekickmartialartsradio.com is where we keep all the show notes. So this will get its own page.
Hey, maybe you can put a poll up and see what your viewers think of this movie.
Yeah. Yeah, we can do that.
Cool.
See how many of them have seen it. So how about actors? Is anybody that's a favorite of yours?
Martial art actors or actors in general?
Martial arts actors.
Martial art actors. Donnie Yen's good. I do enjoy Donnie Yen.
Yeah.
A lot of the guys that I like are, it's not, I'm not really watching it for the acting. I'm usually watching it for the choreography, you know?
Right.
But as far as acting is concerned, Donnie Yen is definitely up there in the ranks. Absolutely. Yeah, you kind of took me off guard with that one, buddy. Thanks a lot. Appreciate that.
Hey, I do what I can. You know, this is hard-hitting investigative journalism that we're conducting here. Is there anyone that you enjoy watching as a technician that maybe is a not-so-good actor?
all right, some people are going to hate me for this, but Jet Li.
Really?
You know, I definitely respect him for his acting and his martial arts, but definitely respect him more for the martial arts. But, you know, I guess I haven't really, I don't know. Fist of Legend is definitely my favorite, you know, one of my favorites. And he did a great job in that. But in general, you know, he doesn't like make me go, oh my God, what a performance, you know, as far as acting's concerned. But
he's definitely a better martial artist than he is an actor. Yeah. I mean, I don't think too many people out there are going to argue that. He's a tremendous martial artist.
Oh my God, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So we'll see how much hate mail I get off of that one.
We will absolutely link your email address, home phone number, physical address.
Fantastic.
All of that on the show notes so people can direct all of that hate mail to you and not me.
How dare you not like Jet Li's acting? Damn you.
You know, this show, and maybe I'm going to jinx it now, we get very little hate mail. It's great.
Oh, we need to change that.
It's overwhelmingly positive. So I appreciate that. Hopefully that doesn't change.
Oh, we can make that change right now. No, I'm kidding.
Like you said, we can fix anything in post.
There so we go.
I can make you say anything that I want. Have you seen The Forbidden Kingdom?
I have not.
Jackie Chan and Jet Li.
Yeah, no, I have.
Great film. Great film. You should check that out.
I definitely will now. Is it on Netflix?
I don't know. I don't have Netflix.
Oh, dude. Netflix is great, man.
I have TiVo.
TiVo? Okay.
Yeah. So I just, instead of doing that, I just record everything.
I gotcha.
It works.
Dude, tell you. Netflix, awesome. We actually got rid of cable and just has Netflix. We have basic cable. We don't have all the extras of bells and whistles. We just got basic cable and Netflix. And Netflix, a lot of awesome flicks.
Oh, absolutely. I've had Netflix off and on. Like, I'll go through these phases where I'll get it for a little while and then I'll stop. You know, because, you know, I'll have seen the stuff that I want to see. But just the way that Comcast bundles things for me to drop television, which saved me $1 a month.
Oh, gotcha.
So there's really no point. But have you seen the new season of Daredevil?
Of course. What, season two?
Yeah.
Yes, of course.
Yeah. Listeners, if you like martial arts action, you need to check out Daredevil. It's not just one of the best martial arts, we'll call it a TV show, that's been out there. It's one of the best series I've ever seen.
Mm.
The acting is fantastic. The martial arts, the choreography, all of it's fantastic. So I don't want to put words in your mouth. But.
No, that would actually be hard to argue. It is excellent. It is very well done. Absolutely. Yeah.
So how about books? We know that you're not looking forward to writing your own book, but are you a reader?
Right. I was never been big into books. I think that stems from my ADD. It takes me forever to read books. Maybe I'm sharing a little too much, but in order to read a book, I will, let's just say I'll read a page. I will have to reread that page maybe twice to three times to retain what I've just read. So books to me, I like them and I have them for reference. Like in my acupuncture clinic, you know, I have books for reference. They're not beginning to end books. You know, they're, okay, I need this information. I know where to get it. And I love books. But as far as sitting down casually reading a novel, not me, just because of the, unfortunately, my mind just doesn't work that way. You know, so if it takes a person, you know, a week to read a book, it will take me three. And that's...
Yeah. I understand. I'm in a similar boat.
Yeah. So I love videos, and that's one of the reasons I think I love seminars, doing seminars so much, whether I'm attending them or teaching them, is because that interaction. I have that, you know, kinesthetic and visual, you know, that, you know, information's coming in visually and kinesthetically that I retain it. You know, if someone gave me a training manual, I would be like, okay, this is going to take a while, you know, but it's the application that really does it for me.
Yeah.
So all those people who love to read books go, they're just shaking their head going, oh God. Next person.
Anybody that's taught knows that different people respond to information in different ways.
Absolutely.
You know, you've got to teach it in a different way. And what is a book other than a method for conveying
information?
Right. Right. And I have learned more listening to podcasts over the last couple of years than I have from reading books.
Okay.
Because I can listen when I'm doing something else.
Mm-hmm.
I can just, you know, dedicate part of my brain and I'm able to take in more that way. You know, certainly I'd rather be doing, you know, like, you know, especially if it's martial arts, I'd rather do martial arts than listen to someone and tell me how to do something.
Right, right.
But even that is better than reading about how to do something.
Right, right.
But different people learn in different ways, and that's okay.
Do we talk about, you know, teaching and the way people learn in the preamble, or did we, like the pre-show, or did we talk about it in this?
We talked about it a little bit in both.
In both? All right, rock on.
Yeah.
All right. Because I know for me, once I started teaching in academia, quote unquote, you know, when I started teaching at universities and whatnot, we really started getting into how do people learn. And those three styles of learning, the main three styles of learning being auditory, visual, and kinesthetic, you know, one that helped me learn better, but also helped me become a better teacher. So I know how to present information to each one of those three types of learners. So when I'm teaching a seminar, I need to try to say it, show it, and have them do it, you know? So, and I think that's one of the things, one of the benefits of when I teach is that I try to incorporate that every seminar because I don't know who learns in what method the best, you know? So I need to hit all three.
Right. And I agree. And the conversation you're referencing, that was before we started the show. And so listeners, what he's referencing is we had a discussion talking about the skill set to do and the skill set to teach are very different. And that oftentimes in the martial arts, we just kind of lump them together. Oh, you have achieved such and such rank. You're qualified to go teach, go do it.
Mm.
And, you know, we talked about how those were separate and you even brought up an example of one of your instructors saying that they had known ninth dons that couldn't teach and first dons that could.
Mm. That was a little bit more about rank, not less more about teaching, but more about rank because we had talked about rank as well. It's like, you know, for me, rank is secondary. You know, me, it's more about the skill and the application, you know, because people say, oh, knowledge is power. I think that's crap. Knowledge is not power. It's the application of knowledge that's power. You know, am I learning something so I know something? But if I can't apply it, what good is it? You know, I'm not learning something to make somebody go, wow, he's so smart. Oh, wow. You know, I really could care less about that. Whatever I take in, I need to be able to apply that or else that's worthless information to me. So, wow, did I just go off on a binge, brother? Sorry.
No, that's great. This is what the show is all about. Those tangents are gold.
Hopefully you'll be able to edit that in somewhere.
No, it's going to leave it right there. Woo! It's where it belongs.
Awesome.
We're taking the audience on a ride. They don't know. Hey, anybody that's been listening for a little bit knows they don't always know what they're going to get when they tune in. Sometimes we wander around. Sometimes in the Thursday shows that are just me talking about a subject or profiling a movie, sometimes I wander a bit and that's okay because I think all of us have had a martial arts instructor who wanders. So we kind of get used to that in this realm.
Oh, I remember now. We were talking about my old teacher. Actually, he's my current teacher, actually. Grandmaster Lim. Grandmaster Lim Young-soo. He's in Daegu, Korea. He's my Hapkido instructor. And in our association, our master's certificate, our master rank is separate than our first dan, second dan, third dan. So it doesn't matter what rank you are. You test for your master's certificate when it's time. And so I was in Korea. And we were just training, and my teacher goes, LaCava, this year you test a master certificate. And I was like, I appreciate it, but I'm only third dan. He's like, oh, no. Master when I say master. And I was like, oh, all right. He goes, sometimes I have seen some people not sixth dan, seventh dan, ninth dan, no master. Then I see sometimes first dan, second dan, third dan, master. So master is not about rank. It's not about the rank, the number rank. It's when you're ready. And when he said that, I was like, wow, I felt really special, but I was like, wow, that's pretty deep too.
So let's unpack that, because I had taken that to mean one's ability to teach, but you're saying that that's a little different.
No, so, one's ability to do. So a teaching certificate would be different.
Okay, so let's say, give me an example. Let's say I'm a fourth degree in your system, and I've got somebody else who's also a fourth degree, but I've got a master's certificate and they don't. What's the difference?
What is the difference? To be honest, once again, rank for me isn't that big of a thing, but I guess maybe it's recognition. Maybe I would be taught a little differently if I did or didn't have my master's certificate. Maybe, I don't know. But I think for me, it's showing me that my teacher believes in me enough and what I can do, that it's just a form of appreciation. Be like, you know what? Good job. Keep up the hard work. Don't screw off. You know?
Okay. All right. I get it now.
So,
okay, that's really different than what a lot of schools are. I'd say the vast majority of schools or styles do. So it's interesting to hear that.
Yeah. Like for my master's certificate, I mean, it may be different for other people within the association. In our association, we do Hapkido and we also do Chungsuk Gahapdo. Chungsuk Gahapdo is a sword style, which my teacher, Grandmaster Lim, studied Musa Jikin and Eishin Ru, which is a Japanese sword style. And he also studied Korean sword styles. So what he did is he blended them together to create Chungsuk Gahapdo. And the other reason why he created it is because, you know, up to this point, there's been quite a bit of turmoil between Japan and Korea, you know, with the Japanese occupation of Korea. Well, This was him trying to bridge people together, you know, trying to bring people together, bridge those gaps that have been happening over the years, over the decades, actually. And so created this style, Chungsuk Gahapdo, which from the outside perspective, looks very Japanese. It looks very Muso Jikin and Eishin Ru based. So getting back to the original topic was, for my master's certificate, I just didn't have to do Hapkido. I had to do Hapkido and Gohapdo for my test. So I needed a certain level of proficiency in both in order to get my master's certificate.
Okay.
You know? And the funny thing is that when I first went to Korea, you know, I just wanted to be a Hapkido guy. I didn't want to do sword. I didn't want to do any of that, you know? And so when we get to Korea, first time I ever get to Korea, which is, oh, dude, there's a bunch of stories right there. Holy crap. All right. But anyway, first time I go to Korea, we're talking with Grandmaster Lim, and he says, okay, so morning session, Hapkido. What do you want to do in the afternoon? And I was like, I'd like to do Hapkido in the afternoon. And he had that kind of confused look on my face. And I was like, he goes, no Gahapdo? I said, no, I just want to be a Hapkido man. You know, I want my Hapkido to be, you know, top notch. And he's like, oh. And he goes, then maybe you do Gahapdo. And I know I had that confused look on my face. And he's like, those people who do Hapkido, their Gahapdo gets better. And those people who do Gahapdo, their Hapkido gets better. And at first, I just thought it was kind of like a sales gimmick. And I was just like, eh. But I thought to myself, I'm like, you know what? I trust him. Okay. And he created this style. I'm in Korea. Why? I would be a fool not to take advantage of an opportunity to train with a founder of a style, you know, when it's offered to me by him. And it's like, so I was like, okay, morning Hapkido, afternoon Gohapdo. And as I continued on, he was right. Dude, I couldn't believe it. It's like, okay, you have Hapkido. Our Hapkido is a very physical style, you know, but you need another person in order to get their energy and to work with resistance and all that. You need another person. Gohapdo is primarily solo practice. But what I've come to find out is that a lot of the footwork, the body positioning, the hand movements are there. There's a lot of crossover between the two. And then I really started to get what he was saying. It's like, now I get why if somebody does one style, the other style gets better. You know, you've got Hapkido where you're training with other people. And then you've got Gohapdo when you're training by yourself and you're still practicing both arts no matter what you're doing. And I was like, wow, that's awesome. So, yeah, That's my my story about that.
So you seem to have this epiphany moment remembering a block of stories when you went to Korea. Is there any one of those you want to pull out for us?
Oh man. All right, getting to Korea was like crazy. All right, this was 2003 and never been to Korea before in my life. Very limited knowledge of Korean. I was in acupuncture school and I had some Koreans in my acupuncture class, so they were kind enough to help me with my beginning learning of Korean. And so pretty much I knew very little to nothing. We'll just put it that way. But we fly over to Korea. Then from there, we were supposed to jump on another plane and fly down to Daegu. So we fly into Incheon, which is up near Seoul. And then we take another plane down to Daegu, where my teacher is. And so we fly there. And this is September 11th, 2003. So this is 2 years, 3 years after, 2 years, 2 years after the World Trade Center. And we're flying out of Boston. So I'm a little freaking out a little bit, you know, because hopefully lightning doesn't strike twice. You with me on that?
I am.
All right. So we fly over to Korea. We get to Incheon. All is good in the world. Korean Air is awesome. Really good airline. I digress. Moving back on topic. we get to Incheon and we're trying to buy tickets to the next flight down to Daegu because they fly all the time down, you know, in country. They're flying all the time. And so we're trying to buy, and all the people that we keep trying to buy tickets from, they're taking their index fingers and crossing them, and they're going, tepu, tepu, tepu. And we're like, what? Well, I don't get it. What do you mean, tepu? Come to find out, typhoon.
Oh.
So no flights in or out of the airport at that time. So now we still need to get down to Daegu, and we're like, what the hell are we going to do? I've never been there before, so I'm totally relying on everybody, on the other two guys that are the primary guys who have been there before. So I'm like, what do we do, guys? So I'm following their lead. So instead of a 45-minute plane ride down to Daegu, this was before the KTX, the bullet train, was implemented. So before then, we ended up taking, instead of a 45-minute plane ride, a five-hour bus trip through the typhoon. Oh my God, we're going through the typhoon. This bus driver's driving like a bat out of hell. Like, we're gonna die. I mean, cars are swerving off the road. He's kind of, you know, tail spinning a little bit and whatnot. So we ended up pulling over into this rest stop, and we just start buying liquor. We were like, if we're gonna die, I don't want to feel this. So we just start pounding. We eventually made it there, and it was awesome. But let's see, from when we started to when we got to Daegu, it was probably about 35 hours, which normally shouldn't take that long. Normally a flight will take between 12 to 14 hours, you know, and then another 2 hours down, you know, and you're where we're at. So this is my first year in Korea, and my parents expected a phone call from me when I got there. So my parents are seeing pictures of Korea with boats into buildings and signs down and cars flipped over from the typhoon. They wrote me off. Like, oh my God, my son is dead. Oh my God. So finally I called them. They were pissed off, but yet happy that I was still alive. But that was a trip from hell. Every trip after that was fantastic compared to it.
All right. So remind me not to travel to Korea with you.
No, you can travel with me now. That first time was terrible. Every time since, great. No problem.
But it would be my first time. So maybe there's some bad luck.
No, I'd be your good luck
first
time.
I got
rid of all the bad luck for anybody I bring.
Okay, good. Good. That's good to know. Well, then maybe I will go to Korea with
you. Oh, it'll be a good time. We'll have a blast. You know, they train us hard, but they treat us really well. Sometimes you'll hear people talk about, oh, the Koreans, they beat up on the Americans. And that's not true here. I mean, we train hard. Like, don't get me wrong. We train hard, but we don't get anything that anybody else doesn't get. You know, everybody else gets the same thing as we get. And so it's not like, uh-oh, we're going to mess up the round eye on this one. You know, not like that at all. It's, they train us hard, but they treat us well. You know, they take care of us. You know, they're really good to us. And I'm very fortunate to have my friends and you know, martial arts family in Korea.
Rock on. Yeah. So what's keeping you going? You got any goals you're working towards?
Goals. I'd like to start doing, well, big goal, besides the quote I said before, you know, I just want to be, have a comfortable life, you know, being able to support my family on things I love to do and things that I'm that I love to do, martial arts, music, whatever. I like to be able to provide for my family doing those things. So I'd like to increase my seminar schedule. You know, I'd like to, you know, start doing DVDs and instructional videos, because a lot, you know, I get this every time when I go to a seminar, I'm like down in Texas or I'm in Virginia or I'm in, Georgia or wherever, you know, they're like, I'll do a seminar. Everybody's pumped. They're like, woo. All right. Hey, do you got any DVDs? I'm like, oh crap. I don't. So it's like, you know, I sell merchandise and whatnot. You know, I have t-shirts and all that kind of good stuff. But I would like to start producing some instructional DVDs to help, you know, people that, you know, when I go places, to help them remember the information that I'm putting out, or maybe get some new information, or get some new information that they might be able to adapt to something they already do. So where people can start seeing the connections. You know, 'cause a lot of people in the martial arts, they look for the differences, where I look for the similarities. And a lot of my friends, I feel the same way. They look for the similarities, you know?
I do. Yeah. I absolutely do. I like tying things together and seeing how similar even the most disparate of arts really are at the heart of them.
Oh, yeah. You know, and that's one of the things with teaching at some, a lot of these conferences, I get to rub elbows with some pretty big wigs, you know, guys who've been in it twice as long as I have, you know, and guys who have been there and done that, you know, and I watch them and I train with them and I watch everybody because I love watching and seeing and putting things together. And when you get down to it, a lot of these guys move the same. Their principles are very similar, if not the same. They just have different ways they talk about it and different ways they go about it. But it's very much the same. You've heard the mountain analogy, right?
Probably, but all right. Elaborate.
Martial arts is a mountain, right? And you have martial arts all on the base of the mountain, all around the mountain. You know, everybody sees different things on the way up. But once they get to the top, everybody sees the same thing.
I like that.
You know, and you can even take it even farther if you wanted to. You know, you have on one side of the mountain, you have Tung Su Do, you have Taekwondo, you have styles that are very similar. They're going up their own path and they may see similar things, but yet they'll still see little differences because it's their path. Now, if you look all the way on the other side of the mountain, say like Judo or Goto or something, you know, a weapons base or whatnot, you're going to see something totally different than what they see on the other side of the mountain. But yet when they get up to the top, they still all see the same thing.
I like that.
You picking up what I'm laying down, brother?
I am. This is good stuff. Good stuff.
Sometimes I can get deep. Wow.
So you've mentioned a few times the fact that you do offer seminars and whatnot. So if someone wants to book you for a seminar, or, you know, attend one that you've already got planned, you know, this is kind of your commercial time.
Oh, okay.
So how can people know more about that?
Facebook is a great way to get a hold of me. And I have a Facebook page. So my Facebook page, my teacher page is facebook.com/ Chris LaCava, LAC. So that's CHRIS. LACAVALAC. And that's my page.
Okay. And we'll definitely link that at the show notes.
I appreciate that.
Cool. How many seminars are you doing? It sounds like you do a fair number of them.
I do right now. I'm doing about two a month.
Wow. It's keeping you out there.
Yeah. So I think next month, May, June. Yeah, next month I'll be in Georgia. Looking forward to that. And, you know, it's cool, once again, you know, when I can kind of mix things together. So I'm teaching a seminar in Georgia, but at that weekend, there's also Blade Show going on in Atlanta. So I get to check out Blade Show while I'm down there, which is really cool.
Nice. Nice. Because you're also a knife guy, aren't
you? Yeah.
We didn't really talk about that.
Yeah. I study Kali. Love knives ever since I was a little kid. I also train under Hawk Hockheim. I'm a certified knife instructor under him. And I teach a lot of knife combatives course. You know, a lot of people teach defense against a knife, and I teach that. But one class that really seems to be very popular with people from me is my tactical knife proficiency classes. I teach a class called DRO, which stands for deployment, retention, and obstructions. Those are the three things that you really need to be aware of and not master, but be able to pull off or try to negate in any kind of altercation in self-defense. So it's primarily self-defense using a knife.
Cool. Yeah. Rock on.
Thanks, brother.
Hey, all right. So as we wind up, I mean, not that you haven't dropped a ton of wisdom on all of us today, but
hopefully you can mix something down good, bro.
Hey, without a doubt, but let's end on the highest of notes. Do you have any parting advice for everyone listening?
Follow your dreams. No, you know what? Besides that quote, this was said to me at a conference by Bruce Jutnick. He said to me, don't take yourself too seriously. Take what you do seriously. And he might have turned it around saying it the other way, but it still means the same thing. Do take what you do seriously, but don't take yourself too seriously, because a lot of people in the martial arts get hung up on, you know, being top dog, grand poobah, being bigger than somebody else. And that's where we stop learning. And that's where we kind of fall down a black hole. So no matter what, when you're training in the martial arts, love what you do, but don't take yourself too seriously. Enjoy it. Laugh.
Thank you for listening to episode 84 of Whistlekick Martial Arts Radio, and thank you to Master LaCava. Head on over to whistlekickmartialartsradio.com for the show notes, including links to everything we talked about today. If you like the show, make sure you're subscribing or using one of our free apps. They're available on both iOS and Android. For those of you kind enough to leave us a review, remember we randomly check out the different podcast review sites like iTunes, Stitcher, and more. And if we find your review and mention it on the air, be sure to email us for your free box of Whistlekick stuff. If you haven't left us a review yet, please do help us out and leave one. Those reviews are a lot more important than you may realize. If you know someone that would be a great interview for the show, please fill out the form at whistlekickmartialartsradio.com, or if you want to shoot us a message with a suggestion for a Thursday show or just some other feedback, we'd love to hear from you, and there's a place to do that on the website too. You can follow us on social media. We're on Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, and Instagram, pretty much everywhere you can think of, and our username is always Whistlekick. Every episode is also on YouTube, so check us out there if you have a chance. And remember the products you can find at whistlekick.com or on Amazon, like our awesome sparring gear. If you're a school owner or team coach, you should check out wholesale.whistlekick.com for a special wholesale program. But that's all from us today. So until next time, train hard, smile, and have a great day. But don't forget the amazing training opportunity we have coming up this July in Vermont. The Whistlekick Martial Arts Weekend features a growing list of instructors, including me, who will be offering seminars that cover a wide variety of martial arts disciplines and subjects, including Master Cheryl Medley, who will be offering seminars on historical European martial arts. That's right, sword and shield stuff. With multiple seminar choices during each of the many training blocks, the hardest part will be deciding which of the great sessions to take. One low price covers your entire weekend of training, all your meals, great event shirt, and a private room. Can't make the whole weekend? Day passes are available. So make sure you're there on July 8th, 9th, and 10th for all of the learning and the fun. Head on over to martialartsweekend.com for more information and to sign up. Don't wait. Space is limited.